that wasted us required of us now. Say, sing us one of the songs of Zion. How shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? If I forget thee, O Jerusalem, let my right hand forget from coming. If I do not remember thee, let my tongue cleave to the roof of my mouth, if I prefer not Jerusalem above my chief joy.
Let us open our Bibles to Psalms 137. Psalms 1:7. And thank the young lady for reading it. I saw where 1:7. We're going to read from verse 1 to 6. We're going to read from verse 1 to 6. I'm reading from the New King James Version. I am reading from the New King James Version. And by the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down. Yea, we wept when we remembered Zion. We hung our harps upon the willows in the midst of it. For there are those who carry us away captive, ask of us a song. And those who plundered us requested murmur, saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion. How shall we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? If I forget you, O Jerusalem, let my right hand forget its skill. If I do not remember you, let my tongue cling to the roof of my mouth. If I do not exalt Jerusalem above my chief joy. Title of our message this afternoon is, how can we sing? How can we sing? You see, the Babylonians had taken the children of Israel into captivity. Babylon was known for the many waters. Most of the important water course was the Euphrates, which has many tributaries, you see. The captive had restored to the banks of the rivers. And as they were sitting there, I can imagine they sat on the course of the tributaries. They could hear the percolating waters as they wandered through those tributaries. They could hear the sound and the beauty of the waters as they intermingled between the stones and the marshes and through the shrubs. And so they sat there and they began to remember Zion, you see. They began to remember where they came from. You see, they were a prosperous people. But Babylon was nothing like home. They had been taken into exile. And if you remember Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and if you remember David as well, they all had been taken into captivity. And so this is where a situation where the Israelites find themselves. They are in captivity. And they are sitting by the river. Babylon was nothing like it. And when they looked back, they saw that Zion lay in ruins. It had once been a capital of a religious center, of a proud and prosperous people. Its walls and towers stood majestic against the heavens. The golden arch of its grandiose temple shimmered like a beauty in daybreak. Caravans went back and forth into the city. It was like a marketplace. Everywhere you looked, you could see the blessing of God. I can imagine myself a situation where I'm in captivity. And I remember back home. Right now when I think of back home, I think of the marketplace. I can think as I'm walking through, as the buses come, and people are coming from different places to buy from the market. I can think of a situation where the minibuses and the local transportation are coming into the city. And a lot of people are converging at the market. In my mind, I can imagine the mango tree. I can see the mangoes being spread out all over the marketplace. And I can smell the sound as they begin to unveil them. And as I look at the beauty of all those mangoes, I say to myself, I wish I could grab one of them. I can see the cars are still coming, maybe they hit a little portal and the car goes scuttering up into the audience. I can see the children in uniform, maybe singing little songs and carrying their little bags and heading off in different directions to school. When I think of Zion, I think of the marketplace. I think of that situation. And so, as I begin to recall in my mind, I'm beginning to imagine how the children of Israel were beginning to feel. You see, they were taken captivity, and they were remembering how it was back home. Just like when I'm here, I begin to remember some of the things that are so dear to me from back home. And so they sat there as they were beginning to remember. And then as they sat there, people were being sarcastic. Those who had captured them are telling them, sing us one of those songs of Zion. You can imagine when you've been beaten. You can imagine when somebody has done all kinds of hate to you. You can imagine that they've done the things that you could not conceive. And then they expect you to sing. Then they beat you right, left, and center. They torture you. They bring you into captivity. And as you are resting on the river, enjoying the serenity of the course, they come and taunt you some more and say, come, sing us a song of Zion. Yes, I love music. Yes, I love to sing. And I know a lot of you sing. But at that moment, when I'm feeling like I am down, it is difficult for me to lift up my voice and sing. And so they found themselves in that situation. Israel was already struggling with what they were going through. And now they were being tortured, being told to sing. They remembered the pain of being desolate in a foreign land. They longed to be back home, you see. But the people of this city turned. They had turned from God. And that's why they were taken from captivity. Be careful to turn away from God. The children of Israel had turned away from God. They were selfish. They were unrighteous. And their sin brought them low. In fact, Proverbs 14:34 says, righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a disgrace to any people. Sin is an equal opportunity destroyed. Sin perverts a nation. Sin isolates us from God. Sin compels us to make the wrong choices. Sin brings about our demise. And so sin brought them to that place. Our flames and the sword had brutalized the city. They had left it. Its citizens were carried away into captivity. Babylon had taken them. The remembrance of that holy city, especially their temple, now lay in ruins. You can imagine that the church that you left back home, maybe you sat as a committee and you spent time and you built that temple. You did everything possible because anything that is God, you do to the best of our abilities and it has to be beautiful. And so you can imagine, and then somebody comes in and takes it into captive and then ruins the whole church that you built. You can imagine how they're feeling in their mind. You see, that was their pride. The church was their pride. When they look at the grandiose of that temple, that's what connected them. Where they came from. So the remembrance of the holy city and especially the temple now laying in ruins, it makes their hearts so sorrowful that they found it impossible to restrain their tears, you see. To them there was no land like that. It was a godly land that held so many precious memories for them. But you see, memories sometimes bring us to ask questions. When something goes wrong in your life, you begin to ask questions. You ask yourself, where did I go wrong then? What is it that I did that caused me to be put in this place? What happened to me at that point? How do I find myself here today? I'm sure there are times when you yourself have asked those questions. When you have faced adversity. I know somebody has faced adversity in here. Those of you perhaps who've come from different countries and you imagine a different way in which you're going to come here and how your circumstances were going to change. And because you looked at perhaps America and perhaps you looked at Canada and maybe when you watched the documentaries and you saw television and you saw how wonderful it looked. You saw that they have the great city of Toronto. Perhaps you looked at Calgary, or maybe you're looking at America. You saw LA and New York, and you told yourself, I got to go to America. And so you packed your bags and you prepared and you went to America. You probably left your fine job. A job probably that gives you a month vacation or two. A job that probably gives you a driver. A job that probably pays your rent, not from your own pocket, but the company actually pays for it. Some of you have those jobs? You had somebody who could take care of your home while you were at work. Everything was taken care of, and you were lacking in nothing. And yet, you had this picture of America, you told yourself, I guess you go there. And so you came there, and it turned out it's not all that you had imagined. You see that the children of Israel were taken into captivity, not of their own volition, you see, but you broke yourself. And you begin to ask yourself the questions, but why? The grandiose job that you thought you were going to get, you come and you end up in not so a grandiose job. And when you're sitting there and you're beginning to think to yourself, oh, why did I do this? I know eventually you are just, but you still begin to ask those questions. They were taken into captivity. They were beginning to ask those questions. They went wrong. And that's what happens sometimes when we separate ourselves to God. We need to remain connected with God. If we do not remain connected with God, we will begin to ask ourselves questions. These people separated themselves from God, and they found themselves in a situation, and now they're asking, why should we say these people are being sarcastic, they are teasing us, they are saying, sing the songs of Zion. The sorrow triggered by the loss of Zion seemed overwhelming to the Israelites. As if that was not enough, their captors only made it worse by their invitation. They say, why don't you sing as one of those songs of Zion? But the exiled Israelites could not find room in their hearts. Have you ever noticed how, when you are a Christian, suddenly people don't seem to be aware when things are going right. They'll wait until you do something wrong. And then they'll come to you and say, oh, I did not know you're also a Christian. So you also dress like that. Oh, so you also do such and such. They found themselves in a difficult situation. The Israelites responded in verse 4, how can we sing the songs of the Lord while in a foreign land? They refused to sing the songs of Zion because their great city had been denied, their loved ones destroyed, lifestyle had been displaced, and this plagued power had taken over. How can I live there? It will take a lot out of me to sing in a situation like that. So they refused to sing. What did they say in verse 4 to 6? They say, how can we sing songs of the Lord while in the foreign land? For I forget you. If I forget you, O Jerusalem, my right hand forget its skill. They were willing to forget completely their song. They were not playing the music because they were in this land where they were taking captive. In fact, their tongue got stuck to the top of their mouth so that they do not have to sing. That's how angry they were about the situation. To them, to have consented to sing a song of the temple under these conditions would have seemed to the Israelites like being unfaithful to their beloved city. They had taken it to heart. Sooner would they forget their most treasured possession than forget Zion. Their pride was dead. All the glory that they knew was in Israel. They would rather lose their ability to speak or sing than to appease these guys. It reminds me of some of us. You have a beautiful voice. And then you sing, and then somebody says something a little negative, and you say, I'm not going to sing anymore. And sometimes it's meant to help you. You see, they were taken into captivity because of the disobedience to God in the first place. And so they were meant to be corrected. But no, they chose not to. And so they ended up in this situation. Or when somebody tries to correct you, they say, oh, no, I can't do that. I'm not going to go to church anymore because the elder said such and such. Oh, that brother over there, I just didn't like the way he came at me. And sometimes people do well. And sometimes we need to acknowledge this. Of course, there are certain times when people are negative. Yes, but there are some times when people need me well. And we need to be open to that. And so how can they sing this song when they found themselves in this situation? And sometimes we get disappointed by people. And we say, oh no, I'm not going to take that person anymore. Sometimes we get disappointed by maybe a few guys that you dated, or maybe a few girls that you dated. And just, oh no, I'm just going to be single. I'm not going to date anymore. Until the next fine brother or sister comes along. How can we sing a song of Zion when we're in this foreign land? I don't know about you, but I think by singing, they could have shown their effectiveness and gratitude that they had for the Lord. They would have been thankful and say, thank you for bringing us into this place, for we needed deliverance. After all, does not the scripture say in 1 Thessalonians 5:18, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. They could have shown that God's presence is not limited to geography. Romans 8:38 says, neither height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God. And they could have shown that despite their predicament, that their faith in God was unshakable. They could have shown that they serve the God who is faithful in a heartless world. They could have remained faithful even when they were going through circumstances. But the pain of the devastated land was too much to bear. Their grief and their loss of their beloved and their great city and the great temple that they had built was still in mind. They were so devastated they could not relinquish that pain. Their great edifice of worship was glued in their mind and it was too agonizing to relinquish. They couldn't shake it off, no matter what happened. They stood there and they mourned. The children of Zion decided to hold their peace and shut their mouths. The question of singing the Lord's song in a foreign land is not new. When we are faced with a quandary of how to sing and remain optimistic in the face of failure, do we sing? When there's a setback or loss, we ask ourselves, how can we sing when all this suffering is taking place? How can we sing when my child is sick? How can I sing when I cannot begin to even pay the bills? How can I sing when 5-6 months, close to a year, I have no job and that I cannot take care of myself? How can I sing when my wife has left me? How can I sing when I'm struggling with my children? How can I sing when I cannot provide for them? How can I sing when I am struggling in school? How can I sing when I found myself in this situation and I cannot seem to get out of it? How can we sing when we hear about all these things happening in the world? We are in a foreign land. It says this is not our home. But Israel should have sung, in my opinion. Israel should have sung. Their hearts should have been tuned to play the music of Zion. They should have loosened their tongues and come to sing the song of Zion. They should have stretched their arms and pulled out their hearts and begin to play the music of Zion.
that music, knowing that it doesn't matter where they are, God is always with them. Not only that, they would have shown that they are a witness. It doesn't matter even if they're taken into captivity. They say they're mighty and living God. So nothing can face them, even if they're in captivity.
Jesus left us an example of singing in the rain of suffering, and even after chained to death. At what place that we can find is where it says Jesus sang. Matthew 26:30 says, when they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. They sang. Allow me to propose that Jesus sang at the night of betrayal. He sang when he was washing the disciples' feet. He sang at Judas as he hurried to betray. He sang at the end of the last supper. He sang as he was handed over in anguish and in pain. He sang through his difficulties because he knew the power. He knew what he was doing it for. He knew why he was doing it. He knew was with me, and he was going to overcome because of the presence of the Almighty. He knew he was doing it for you and me, and that was his biggest motivation. You are special. He was willing to die. He knew. What is your motivation? When you are faced with troubling circumstances, what is it that you do? We should permit our praise to bring about deliverance. 1 Thessalonians 5:18 says, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Ephesians 5:20 also says, always giving thanks to God and the Father for everything in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. You see, we begin to scatter Satan when we sing. You see, you find yourself in a difficult situation. And there's no better way to respond to that situation with goodness. He brings it for bad, but you turn it around and make it good. If you try to do enemies, they try to provoke you, they try to do all kinds of things against you, but if you turn it around and make it for good, it begins to startle them too. We startle the devil when we turn it into a positive thing, where he expects that there will be hand. You smile. When he expects that there will be animosity, you come together. When he expects that there will be disunity, you unify. When he expects that you will be able to destroy, you remain faithful. Allow me to get a little excited. You see, the enemy expects us to respond to life's trials and complaints with aggravation. And sometimes we do enough of that complaint. Oh, I don't know why he did this and that. Oh, we have suffered enough. Oh, I don't know why they put it in that way. Or they did it like that. Too much of that. Let's talk to God first. Let's consult God first. Let's not spend most of our energy and time complaining. It takes too much time. Easier just to get together and fix the problem. Allow me to get a little excited here. You see, when God begins to come through in your life, you get excited, you see. When you are faced with pain, and nothing can shake you, you get excited. Let me remind you of Joshua, for instance. When the trumpet sounded, the people shouted, and the sound of the trumpet went forth, and the people gave a loud shout, and as they shouted, the city of Jericho began to crumble, and it crumbled down, and the people went into the city and were able to capture it. Oh, but that's not it. When Moses went with the children of Israel, as they walked away from the Egyptians, as they walked because they were following God, he was able to deliver it from Pharaoh and his men. And as they crossed over into the Red Sea, as they parted, they were able to walk through the dry ground, and they walked over and crossed
to the other side. Guess what they did? They sang after the victory. Not only that, I'm reminded of something called Paul. They were in prison and they were chained. They were unjustly put in prison, you see. And as they were sitting there, somebody started this love that makes us happy. And so they began to sing. And so their voices would be heard into the prison walls. And as the more, as you said, you see, then the more the power of God was beginning to come down. And as they sing, the chains begin to break off. And they were free.
Oh, there's beauty in singing. There's joyfulness in singing. Their joyful singing aroused the heavens and the earth shook. And everything fell apart. Praise brings about deliverance. When you're struggling, give praise. Often we have heard visitors coming from Africa. Sometimes in the island, and sometimes in the Pacific. They always say, we went to Jamaica, or we went to Haiti, or we went to Zimbabwe, or we went to Nigeria. The people there are struggling. You can see that they barely have any clothes on. But you see, there's something that I noticed that is different. They're happy people.
Yes.
With the little that they have, they're able to share. With the little that they have, they are content. Compare us to the many that we have, the much that is perceived, and this will not happen. Here are the people with very little, yet they are happy. And now, folks, I don't know about you, other places, I've been to other places, but where I am, where I come from, in Zambia, we sing. We sing everywhere. We sing at company, we sing at home. We sing when we're just walking on the street, we sing. When we get on the bus and we're going somewhere, we sing. Oh, we sing when we're at home. And we sing when our relatives come over to visit. We sing when we get into the car to go to vacation. Oh, we sing when we meet our friends. Oh, we sing everywhere. Sometimes we just sing for no reason. We sing everywhere. Shows the mark of the happy people. It doesn't matter where they go, they sing. I also today I acknowledge you. Are you going through something? Are you struggling through something? Are you going through something? Something that is making you struggle today. And you sing when you are shackled with the problems that the devil is trying to captivate you. Do you give praise when you're struggling in your life? Ellen White says there will be music there. A song and such music and a song that saved in the visions of God, no mortal ear has heard and mind conceived. As well as the singers and the players on instrument shall be there. Psalms 8:7 says, they shall lift up their voice, they shall sing for the majesty of the Lord. Isaiah 24:14 says, for the Lord shall comfort Zion, he will comfort all our worst places, and he will make our wilderness like Eden. Like the garden of the Lord, joy and gladness shall be found there. Thanksgiving and the voice of melody. Music is able to transform the soul. Sometimes the word takes a very strong presence in our lives, and it's good to stay in the word. But in this situation, when you're going through something, and you're going through a struggle, and for some reason a song just pops into your head. Remember that the Holy Spirit imbued on your heart that this is the answer that I have for you. And you just begin to sing. Somehow it just soothes your soul, you see. Look at what happens to the slaves. They were brought all the way from their land. They were brought all the way into America. You can imagine what they went through. The difficulty they went through, the suffering that they went through, and then they made it. And when they got here, they had limited abilities. They could not easily communicate. But through music, they found a way to communicate. And through music, they found a way to interact. Through you cannot blame somebody who's going through something when they refuse to sin. Yes, we all do things differently. And sometimes it's hard when you're struggling with something and you are trying to encourage yourself in the Lord. And you're trying to find something that will give you some kind of relief. Am I your hopeful? Say it.
Amen.
If you are going through something, say it. When you are struggling with your sin, when the new collectors are calling every day, sin. When you are faced with prejudice, I say sin. When your boyfriend or girlfriend is frustrating you, I say sin. When the snow has blocked you and you cannot seem to get out and your car is stuck, sin. When there's trouble in the church, sin. When you're struggling with your partner, sin. When the children are giving you problems, sin. All this deliverance and joy in sin, you see. And the great controversy is that with the Lamb upon Mount Zion, having the heart of God, they stand at the 144,000 that were redeemed from among men. They heard the sound of many waters. And as the sound of the great thunder, the voice of harpers happened with their harps, and they sing a new song. Before them, the throne, a song which no man learned save the 144,000. None of the 144,000 can learn that song, for it is the song of their experience, an experience such as no other have ever heard before. These are they which follow the Lamb whosoever he goeth. These having been translated from the earth, from among the living, are counted as the first fruits unto God and the Lamb. And in Revelation says, these are they which come out of great tribulation. They have passed through the time of trouble, such as never was seen before in the nation. They have endured the anguish of the time of judgment's come. They have stood without an intercessor to the final outpouring of God's judgment. But they have been delivered, for they have washed their robes and made them as white in the blood of the Lamb. God makes us unique. God is able to transform that which is bad and be able to change it to his benefit. And so when you are struggling, see, let's not be comfortable with this world. It says this world is not our own. In other words, we are exiled on this earth because the devil has taken over. But let's show him that even if he has taken over, this is not our world.
Yes.
We are going to sing through our troubles. It doesn't matter what he brings at us, we'll be able to sing through our troubles. And when that day, great day when the children of Israel and ourselves are taken to that great land, boy, will there be music. I can hear the different melodies that come from different countries. I can hear my very own, for instance. We sing a song in Zambia and we say, Kutana Mwanga, Kukuni Mziwesu. Beyond the river, that's where God has prepared a place for us.
Amen.
I can think of South Africans who sing this in Kusisigelea. God is our king. I can hear the Rwandese singing a song says, Nuwambere. God is the only one who can lift us above all our problems. I can hear the people from the south, when they need strength, they sing, oh, precious Lord, take my hand and lead me home. Did I say the Caribbean? I can say the Caribbean. If you are from the Caribbean and you are going through something, you can sing a song. And the song that comes to mind is, I got my mind made up. And I won't turn back. Someday, this place will be no more. Someday, my God and Savior
very soon. Soon and very soon. My master, my maker, is coming to take me home. Soon he's going to elevate us from this world of trouble. And he's going to call all his children, where we'll be able to celebrate a multicultural music, musical consortium. Let me say that again. We're going to celebrate a what? Multicultural musical consortium of what? Victory! Victory! Victory is mine. Victory is mine.